In this video I'm going to check the flexibility of my spindle, and I'm also going to do any final adjustments to the steps of the X, Y and Z axis. And just to mention, I've already squared the X axis to the Y axis as best I can, trimmed the spindle, which was made a lot easier using the pivot plate method, surfaced the wasteboard, and finally checked the tram of the spindle by measuring the bit squareness against the wasteboard. Anyway, back to the main content of the video.
Main content of the video. Main content of the video. Main content of the video. Main content of the video. Main content of the video.
We really need a pendant. So 0.02, that's pretty good. I'm going to start by pushing the top of the machine. So it doesn't want to tilt that way, it's mainly the nod, and it's 0.1 of a mil. That's not bad considering what I was getting from the previous machines. I am quite close to one side of the x-axis. I think if I was in the center there may be a little bit more twist, but I'll check that later. Backlash in the machine. So I think maybe the coupler or the locking collar has got loose on this side, and that's creating that backlash there. It looks like it's this section here loosened up a bit. It could be any number of things. It could be something slipping on the other end. It could be the motor coupler changing its sort of tension over time, and it could be the grub screw on the locking collar just slipping. It's a lot better, but if you can get split locking collars, the clamping pressure will be across the entire collar and not a single grub screw. Okay, that's gone down to about 0.1 of a mil. Unfortunately, with these type of lead screws and the locking collar, it's kind of as good as you're going to get it. I mean, in terms of movement and the steps, it seems to be okay on this axis, but the backlash is the issue. Okay, so like I said, the steps looks correct and the backlash is still present. There's still some backlash present because of the mechanism and the nut block, and that's about 0.1 of a mil, and I think I'm gonna have to just live with that. Backlash on this is massive. Where's that coming from? So I start by moving the lead screw. It's not great. So it's in this. Okay, that's a lot better. Okay, that's better. I'm now pushing the spindle along the x-axis to see what the play is. So the thing you might not notice when checking the Z is that the weight of the spindle is going to keep it down on the top edge of the thread. But if I lift, you can see, I mean, that's lifting about a mil there. It could be any number of things. It could be, again, the locking collar slipping because it's only a single tiny grub screw holding that in place. In fact, it's definitely that to start with. So I think we'll adjust that first. Definitely not much room to adjust that without taking the spindle out. So the backlash on this is 0.06. I'm now going to cut out a series of shapes so I can test the steps of each of the axes. I'm going to do a couple squares which should be parallel to the X and Y axis. I'm then going to cut out two shapes where the squares are rotated at 45 degrees, and then I'll do a couple circles. And each one I'll do an inner cut and an outer cut. Doing a probe here, can't see it.
I'm going to go over how I used the probe feature and set up my jobs in a separate video, so stay tuned for that. I ran into a few problems with missteps. What shapes I did cut seemed more or less the right size, but the movement between them was incorrect. At first I thought this might have been the motor shaft coupler slipping, but that was fine. I double checked the stepper drivers and it turned out I hadn't set the voltage correctly. It was a little low. That, in conjunction with my acceleration speed being too high, meant that the spindle was moving between shapes, which are larger distances than the circumference of the shapes themselves, and coming to speed without the required voltage and subsequent torque. My stepper motors run at 3 amps, so after reading the manual for my M542T drivers, I chain switches 1 to 3 from 2.8 amps to 3.2 amps on the peak current. But there is also a note that states, due to motor inductance, the actual current in the coil may be smaller than the dynamic current setting, particularly under high speed conditions. This made me wonder whether I could change the current from 3.2 to 4.2 amps on the peak current, because that setting had a reference current of 3 amps. That, and because I'm using switch 4 to reduce the current while the stepper stands still, that could mean I wouldn't ever reach the peak current for long enough to cause problems. Tentatively, I raised the current to 3.2. For the second job, I stopped at 4mm into the material, partly to save time in case something went wrong.
Inside, 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 outside, outside, outside.
And things looked better, but when I began part 2 of the job to complete cutting through the shapes, I noticed the cuts were not lining up and had shifted only along the X axis. This is interesting, but could be the result of a couple factors. It could be the acceleration still affecting the feed rates. The shapes are small and the spindle doesn't reach the maximum feed rate speed while following those vectors because it's still accelerating, and each time it completes the cut and drops down, it starts again. But the distance travelling between shape and to the origin position is large enough to reach the full speed and therefore miss steps. Also, the machine utilises two stepper motors on the Y axis and a single motor on the X.
There is a little bit of flexibility in this. I can't really see the nut block well enough to know if something's wrong with that, but it's not moving. That feels nice and solid. Maybe there's a bit of flex in the lead screw or just travelling too fast, so I'm going to try and drop that down and see if that makes a difference. So I've just changed these down from 40 to 30 millimeters a second, and I'm going to do one shape at a time and see what effect that has. Right, 28.74.
I decided to do a quick stress test by measuring the distance between the gantry plate and the Y plate after homing, and then moving the gantry repeatedly along the X axis back and forth. I then rehomed and measured the distance between the gantry plate and the Y plate again.
28.72, seems fine.
I repeated the cuts using the same method of completing the cutting job at 4mm down, letting the machine return to the origin position, loading the second part as a separate file and cutting down to 18mm.
Okay, that seems a lot better. The issue was the acceleration. So now what I'm going to do is start cutting the parts out so I can measure them.
Making sure to mark the corner so I can keep track of the orientation they were cut, and to then take measurements using my caliper and engineer's square directly from the shapes. I noticed that the squares which had edges parallel with the X and Y axis seemed a lot more accurate at first than the ones rotated at 45 degrees. Even though these shapes are identical in the software, they are cut entirely different. The first uses a single axis at a time, the Y is stationary while the X is moving, and vice versa, to create the square. The squareness of the shape is determined by the squareness of the X axis to the Y axis, while the rotated shape uses the X and Y axis at the same time to create this square shape. If the steps are not set correctly, the shape will be elongated along either the X or Y axis. But the measurements I'm gathering from shape 1 are from the diagonals of the machine. Holding the piece up to an engineer square reveals that it's not in fact square, and both shapes are still not identical.
I can't see any gaps using the square when the piece was cut out parallel to the X and Y axes, and obviously at an angle there is a bit of a gap.
Another way to illustrate this is to cut two circles and to try and fit one shape into the other. If it's not too tight, you will be able to fit the shape in a particular orientation, but it will pinch when rotated. Mine was very tight. I'm now measuring from corner to corner of the square that was cut out at 45 degrees to the X and Y axes. I got 62.20 along the Y and 62.61 along the X. I compared this to the measurements in the CAD drawing and the Y was pretty bang on. And now I need to work out the new step value for the X axis so it produces the same measurements as the Y.
Okay, so to work out the new steps you need to take the current step value for the axis in question. You times it by the distance travelled divided by the the actual distance that it cut, which is 62.6. So the new steps according to this is 396.098.
I put this number back into my control firmware via CNC and did another test cut to see if this had made a difference. The square should be 44mm square or 62.225 from opposite corners. I'm getting 62.20 along the X and 62.17 along the Y, and the square is 44.14
and 44.29.
That's about as good as I can get it.
And that looks square now. That's 59.98. 60.05. The most important thing is that I regularly check that the nut blocks are still in tension and that the motor couplers and the locking collars don't slip now, because it seems to be cutting really well.
I cut a circle and another square, this time with the edges parallel with the X and Y axis. I got 44.00 along the Y axis and 44.03 along the X. So there's still a difference in the measurement when the shape is orientated at 45 degrees. And I think this variation is probably due to backlash in the lead screw caused by the stepper motors changing direction more frequently with the rotated shape. That and the X axis is still ever so slightly off from the Y. Now I've calibrated this as best I can, I've got no idea how to fine tune this anymore. And to be honest, 0.2 of a mil is good enough for how I want to use this machine. I just wish I'd done this before I went and cut the insert nut mounting holes for the wasteboard, which explains why the T-track doesn't line up. Anyway, that's the end of another video, and in the next one, I'll talk about how I set up my stationary tool leveling probe, how that relates to creating cutting jobs, and the settings and macros I use with my CNC software. And that leaves me with the last thing to say, which is thanks again for watching, and you'll see me in the next one. Ooh, and I almost forgot to mention, the DXF plate files and parts lists are now available to subscribers on my Patreon page. So if you're interested in selling your X-Carve and building this machine, please check out the link in the description.